I'm Dr. Joseph MT, Department of Sociology, University of Mumbai. This is the E-Pathshala project on religion and society, and now we are looking at Module 7. In Module 7, we are looking at the monastic traditions of Jainism and Buddhism in India. Now, in this module, we look at how Jainism and Buddhism constitute a very distinct and separate tradition in the Indian social system or religious system, which is the monastic tradition, or rather the Shramana tradition, which is juxtaposed to the Brahmana tradition. Now, in the Shramana or the monastic tradition, both Jainism and Buddhism had evolved as very popular religions. Now, we look at both Vardhamana, Mahavira and the Buddha, and the historical context in which these traditions developed. We look at their development, later development, and we look at the contemporary developments that have happened now. At the same time, we are also looking at the proliferation of differentiated groups and sects within these monastic orders, monastic religions of both Buddhism and Jainism. This is exactly what we are going to do in this module. The period between 600 to 300 BCE, before the Common Era, is one of the intense philosophical speculation and debate. The tradition of questioning can be traced to Upanishads and those of Ajivakas, Charvakas and others. Both the Buddha and Mahavir belong to non-monarchical societies. Both the Buddha and Mahavir lived in urban societies which were connected with increasing craft specialization, trade and an incipient cash economy. The categories of Varna and Jati were becoming more complex. New socio-economic groups such as Gahapati and Sethi become prominent in this period. Both rejected the authority of the Vedas, proclaimed a non-theistic doctrine, emphasized renunciation and human effort as a means to attaining salvation, and established a monastic order of men and women. The life and basic teachings of the Buddha. The Buddha, though born a prince, leaves the material world in the 29th year of his life and attains enlightenment through a process of contemplation and deep meditation. He preaches the Four Noble Truths. Life and the world have sorrow or suffering. Its cause is rooted in desire. There is a cause to suffering. There is also a way to remove this sorrow, and the path to removal was the Eightfold Path. The Eightfold Path consists of right view, intention, speech, action, livelihood, effort, mindfulness, and concentration. This path is known as the Middle Path. The Buddha emphasized impermanence, rejected the idea of anything permanent such as the Atman, accepted the idea of transmigration or samsara, but related karma to moral action. The theory of dependent causation is represented as a wheel of 12 interrelated causes that give rise to suffering. The goal of these teaching was to achieve Nibbana or Nirvana. The Buddha, in his lifetime, is known to have established the monastic order for monks and nuns. The first council held at Rajagruha, the entire Sutta Pitaka and the Vinaya Pitaka were standardized. The second council held at Orvesali, there is first split between the Stavira Vada and the Mahasanghika. Theravada is generally considered as the religion of the book. They believe in the historicity of the Buddha. Their understanding of the world and the Dhamma is rooted in realism. In the Mahayana tradition, the Buddha and the Bodhisattva are deified. He is considered omnipresent and eternal. The practice, therefore, of Mahayana Buddhism became more ritualistic and prayer-oriented. Vajrayana Buddhism or Tantric Buddhism was another form of Buddhism that developed in the 6th to 7th century AD. This form of Buddhism promised the attainment of Buddhahood through esoteric and secret magical practices. Decline and spread of Buddhism outside of India. Buddhism begins to disappear from mainland India, but Eastern Indian monasteries and places of worship continue to receive patronage. Causes of decline include the growing tantric influence on Buddhism, corruption in the Sangha, and growing disconnect between the society and the monasteries. Puranic Hinduism, with emphasis on bhakti, becomes more attractive. Patronage to Hindu deities and support to the Varna ideology by Hindu kings lead to the loss of patronage and persecution of the Buddhist Sanghas. King Ashoka's missions to Sri Lanka, Burma, and the northwest regions led to the establishment of Theravada monastic traditions there. While China, Japan, and Korea have the Pure Land school of Mahayana Buddhism, Chan Buddhism was brought to China by Bodhidharma in the 6th century, and its practice of meditation as well as martial arts became deeply rooted in the Chinese tradition. Zen Buddhism was introduced by Huineng into the Korean Peninsula and Japan. Vajrayana Buddhism entered Tibet, Nepal, and Bhutan. In Tibet, Padmasambhava of Guru Rinpoche introduced this school of thought in the 8th century. Now we come to a very interesting a new development in Buddhism, which we call socially engaged Buddhism. Before this, we need to understand what is engaged Buddhism. Engaged Buddhism is a phenomenon of the 20th century in South and Southeast Asia, following the devastations of the World Wars, the Cold War, and colonialism. Monks from various monasteries are engaged in countering violent and undemocratic governments, economic devastations, and ecological crisis, and in post-colonial India to fight the stigma of untouchability. Everywhere such struggles have been for peace, justice, and through methods that involve Buddhist principle of compassion and universal goodwill. Engaged Buddhism is a term coined by Thich Nhat Hanh, a Vietnamese Buddhist monk trained in both Theravada and Zen Buddhism. Socially engaged Buddhism in Tibet. Tibet was attacked and occupied by the Chinese in the year 1949. Manuscripts and Buddhist antiquities were destroyed and around 1 million Tibetans killed. In 1959, the Dalai Lama, spiritual leader of Tibet, fled to India and still lives here or in India in exile with his people. The Dalai Lama believes that violence, anger, and hatred can only bring about bad karma and sow seeds of violence. The 5-point program for liberation from the Chinese include the return to a liberated homeland and to the Tibetan way of life, and to cease environmental destruction of the natural resources through mining and dumping of natural waste. Socially engaged Buddhism in Vietnam and Cambodia. In Vietnam, between 1963 and 66, the monks and nuns joined an anti-war movement called the Struggle Movement. Some monks and nuns, as well as lay people, self-immolated themselves. They worked selflessly in evacuating villages on both sides on the line of fire. They rebuilt villages and started orphanages, offered medical care and attention to the others. A monk, Thich Nhat Hanh, began working in exile with reconstructing lives of American war veterans. In Cambodia, after the genocidal war begun by Khmer Rouge regime, monk Maha Gosananda began his Dhamma Yatra, or the peace walk, from Thai border, bringing along refugees back home. The Yatra and was training in non-violence and loving kindness and a meditation which helped stall the spate of severe revenge killings after the war in Cambodia to a significant measure. Now, socially engaged Buddhism in Sri Lanka, Myanmar, and India. The military junta in Myanmar has been responsible for mass killings, forced labor, rape of women and children, and violence on ethnic minorities. Aung San Suu Kyi, leader of the National Leader League for Democracy, is dedicated to engaged Buddhism and leads a powerful non-violent movement. In 2007, Buddhist monks joined street demonstration against the rice to fuel course. They publicly overturned their rice bowls, thus indicating that they would not accept donations from the corrupt military regime or their supporters. In Sri Lanka, the Sarvodaya Samadhana aims at resolving the war between Sinhalese majority and the Tamil minority through peaceful and non-violent means. Now, socially engaged Buddhism in Sri Lanka, Myanmar, and India continued. It is also a movement to empower the Sri Lankan villages economically through its self-help programs aimed to provide basic requirements such as clean environment, water, housing, education, basic communications, and energy. In India, the revival of Buddhism can be traced within the colonial context, within the establishment of the Mahabodhi Society in Colombo and translations of many Pali texts. Many Dalit leaders such as Ayoti Thas, E.V. Ramaswamy Periyar were associated with the Shakya Buddhist Society of South India. Most of Dalit movements associated with Buddhism faded away by 1930. It was Babasaheb Ambedkar's conversion and his people's conversion, rounding around 400,000 followers in October 1956 to Buddhism, that was a major turning point for Dalits and for the religious, cultural religious identity of India. Now, this is something that we have looked at with regard to Buddhism. Now, we turn to Jainism and the monastic traditions within Jainism. We begin with the life of Mahavira. Mahavira, the 24th and the last Tirthankara, which means ford maker of the Jain religion, was a contemporary to the Buddha. He is known to have left his household at the age of 30 and wandered as an ascetic for 12 years with a group called Nirgranthas and spent some time with Makali Gosala of the Ajivaga sect. In the 13th year, he attains Keval Jnana or infinite knowledge after severe austerities and through rigorous meditation. He becomes the Jina, the conqueror, and preaches his message. His early disciples were predominantly of the Brahmin caste, who in turn became members of the Sangha. Mahavira preached for 30 years and established a monastic order of monks and priests, nuns, and passed away at the age of 72 at Pava. The Jains believe that reality is manifold or anekanta, which cannot be grasped easily, and the doctrine of Shadavada or maybe, which suggests relativity of knowledge. They believe that the soul or jiva cannot be eternal. The jiva has three main qualities, that of consciousness, bliss, and energy. Jivas transmigrate due to karma. The right knowledge and effort, the jiva can move from bondage to liberation. The ladder leading to bliss is imagined to have 14 rungs. On the 13th stage, Keval Jnana is achieved and one becomes an arhat. On the 14th stage, one becomes the Tirthankara. Jaina discipline consists of the three gems or Triratna, which consists of right faith, right knowledge and right conduct. Right conduct comprises of following the Mahavrittas or the five great vows for the monks and the nuns and Anuvrittas for the laity. Non-injury to living organisms is one of the most important tenets of Jainism. Hence, Jains were required to follow strict vegetarianism, avoiding meat, tubers, and even alcohol. The Shvetambaras and the Digambaras, two differing schools of thought, arose within the Jain community very gradually, perhaps after the 5th century Common Era. These were the white-robed Shvetambaras who wear robes, beg alms and collect these into bowls and eat from them. The other group were the sky-clad or naked Digambaras. They believe that all early Tirthankaras roamed naked and did not use begging bowls. The Digambaras inhabited urban north and central India, southern Maharashtra and Karnataka, and the Shvetambaras in Gujarat, Rajasthan and the Punjab. The Shvetambaras are further divided into Sthanakavasis and Therapanthis, who oppose image worship, and the Mukti Pujaks, who believe in image worship. Murti Pujaks worship in the temple known as the Derasar, while the mendicant community lives in the Upashraya or the monastery. Other institutions of the Jain community, Dharmashalas, are meant as resting houses for pilgrims. Bhojanshala is constructed for availing food for the Jains. The Bandars are ancient storehouses of handwritten and painted manuscripts of Jain religion. For example, the Hemchandra Gnan Mandir in Pathan, Gujarat. The Pinchara Pal is an animal shelter built by Jain communities to give shelter to stray and abandoned animals, especially cows. The Jain community has also built schools, hospitals, technical institutes and hostels. Now, the layperson and worship. The layperson is known as an upasaka or the shravak. The layperson was expected to follow the five lesser vows of the Anuvrtas, which are modeled on the Mahavrtas but much less severe. These include vow of non-violence, the vow of truth, the vow of non-stealing, the vow of curbing sexual appetite, and the vow of non-attachment. The Murti Pujaks or the Maha Mandir Margis from both the Digambara and Shvetambara sect worship at the temple. Worship in the Digambara temple is performed by the Upadhyay, while the Shvetambara temple by the Pujari, who is often a non-Jain priest. Pujas are generally divided into Dravya Puja and Bhava Puja. The Chaitya Vandana is involved various forms of prostrations and recitations of Prakrit and vernacular verses. The Ashta Prakari Puja is divided into two parts. The first of these, Anga and Limb. Okay, we go also to the Jain festivals now. The Jain calendar consists of many festivals connected with the lives and main events of the 24 Jinas. Paryushan Parva consists of sermons by sadhus, fasting, performing pujas and the recitation of Kalpa Sutra. Ayambil Oli involves the worship and meditation on the nine petals of the Siddha Chakra. For the Digambaras, the most important festival is the Maha Mastakabhishek to mark the great asceticism of Bahubali, son of the Jina Rishabhadeva. The colossal statue of Bahubali in Shravana Belahola, Karnataka is bathed with 1008 on the occasion of Maha Mastakabhishek. The Shvetambara pilgrim sites are found generally in Gujarat and Rajasthan, while those of the Digambaras in Maharashtra and Karnataka. The most famous of Shvetambara site is that of Mount Shatrughneya in Palitana, Gujarat. For the Digambaras, the holiest site is of Shravan Balagola. Jainism in the modern world. The encounter with colonial modernity in India. There was an increased emphasis on the scientific and rational character of the religion. The Digambar Panth was influenced by Kundakunda, a medieval Jain philosopher. The Taran Swami Panth criticized the system of the Bhattakaras and image worship and emphasized egalitarian and non-sectarian approach to Jainism. The Kavi Panth advocated achievement of enlightenment without dependence on ascetics and encouraged meditation rather than ritualism. The Kanji Swami Panth has emphasized the non-sectarian path of Jain beliefs. The Shvetambara Panth has advocated the system of Saman and Samani, the Anuvrata movement and the promotion of the Preksha meditation. Viryatan movement was established in 1973 by Acharya Chandana, the first Sthanakvasi nun to become Acharya to provide humanitarian service and education to the masses. So that brings us to the end of Buddhism and Jainism as two monastic traditions in India. At the same time, one would like to add that these are not just monastic traditions, but these can also be seen as heterodoxies as in opposition to Vedic Brahmanism. So in the way that we look at the Shramana and the Brahmana traditions in India, Jainism and Buddhism would fall as the part of Shramana tradition, in opposition to the Brahmana tradition, which has constituted Brahmanism and later the developments in Hinduism. So in that sense, both Jainism and Buddhism, from its classical to their contemporary forms, have a very distinct monastic tradition, which can be named as Shramana in the Indian context. Conclusion, Module 7. This module has concentrated on Buddhism and Jainism. Looking at both of these as monastic traditions, just as Max Weber calls them heterodoxies. We looked at them, their historical development, the proliferation of sects within them, and the contemporary scenario. Thank you.